Good afternoon to you all. Good afternoon. Hi. Maybe after heavy lunch, right? I need to make it more interactive. Thanks for the kind introduction. So what we are going to do in next 40 minutes, what I planned was 30-35 minutes only I'll speak, and we can have some more interaction towards the end. But if it is something is very important, you can raise hand as well. Otherwise, I'll plan at least 5 to 8 minutes towards the end. So as the title indicates, so how many people are familiar with the DevOps? Quite a good number, okay. So what we are talking about here is DevOps is not a new phenomenon, as most of you are already working. So what we are going to do is, what it is different when it comes to the AI? So the people who raised the hands of DevOps, are you already working on the AI? AI models, okay, good. So if you have some best practices, we can interact as well. So because we have mixed audience here, what I have my plan, as you see here, is maybe first a few minutes to set the ground in terms of what are the terminology I'm using so that we will speak on the same language. Second thing, the basic questions of WH question. That means, what is AI DevOps or why we are using it? What are the different challenges when it comes to the AI models in the perspective of AI DevOps? Then, do we need to start from scratch, or are there any reference frameworks? So we are talking about, there are some reference frameworks. I will leave it with you. That's what the first point is. Second thing is, because we may need to deploy the models not just only on the cloud, even on the edge, what are the best practices we can think from that perspective? That's the second takeaway. And I'll use, because I'm representing Ericsson here, I use some cases of telecom domain, but you can apply across your domain. Then the third point is, I leave with you with some of the trade-offs, because as a machine learning engineer or maybe as a data scientist, I hope you agree with me, our day-to-day job is doing a lot of trade-offs. Okay, that may not be the best model. Sometimes you may not be able to satisfy with your model, but still, maybe you need to try and then put it into the production. So just like any other software, right? So what are the trade-offs we are talking about? You can just keep it there. Thank you. So the PLASTER framework is which I got inspiration from NVIDIA, and I added that SET. What does that mean? You will see that. At least those acronyms are for us to remember what are the different trade-offs. So these are the three takeaways which you can expect during the presentation. So the first one is just basic introduction, because in terms of Ericsson, some people, I'm sure most of you know us as a, in the B2B space, where we are providing the technology of 2G, 3G, 4G, and now the 5G thing, right? And on the Internet of Things as well. So the specific unit what I'm representing is a global AI accelerator. So what we do is, across the organization, how we can leverage the new automation cases. How do you be on a thought leadership on that? How do you enhance the portfolio of the company, and not just only for our organization, for our operators? So these are the things which we are talking about through automation, evaluation, and the growth, just like any other organization where the AI can play the role. So we are already around 230 plus now, so we are targeting for 300 people, out of which maybe 100 from India as of now, and we spread across even Sweden and US. How many people can read what is there in the Gartner hype cycle? Very few. So those are the people who may be senior in the industry, but other people who are representing. I may not be able to explain each and every quadrant what you see there. Hope you can see that, the laser point here, not sure. Okay, but I'll leave you with the slide so you can see more details as well. But what we are talking about here is in the, from the Gartner hype cycle, you can see if there are 5 quadrants, right? So what we see is and that too, if you see that, it is only for the AI, not just the general technology, emerging technologies. We have separate hype cycles as well. But my aim is not to just go through all of them. When we speak about AI DevOps, there are 2 aspects which I want you to look into. One is on, there is something like a GPU accelerator, which is almost on the towards the production. We have availability. I remember seeing the NVIDIA and then even Intel also, maybe there are people who are on the hardware side who are providing us these accelerators. So that means hardware is getting ready, not just only the GPU, CPU, you heard these days TPUs, VPUs, right? And even the FPGA, if you see in the middle of it, FPGA accelerators. So once these are ready from our side, how you leverage, not just only from the cloud aspects, but even on the edge device. So some of the aspects which are on that front is AI cloud services, maybe the new things which are going on in 2020 is edge AI, explainable AI. We are not talking about the basic AI, that is making it granted. And as we step into the 2020, what we are going beyond accuracy is not just only the model, take the model and then maybe the best accuracy within the time, that's not the end of the goal. So we are talking about how do you productionize that? That's what really the topic is about. So what I'm referring, the key takeaway from here is some of the aspects of this are talking about the innovation trigger. That means at the very early stage, But there are a lot of aspects of this hardware side or even on the software side which are coming to the mainstream. So we'll talk about some of these going forward. Some common terminology. So even though in the media we are using interchangeably data science, AI and all, just to make sure what I'm talking here in the AI, DL is a subset of ML and ML is a subset of AI. So if you think really in the AI part, apart from DL and maybe machine learning, we talk about even a lot of logic, knowledge building. The next, the Venn diagram, what you see, I'm sure you may be familiar with this, is building the model or maybe the only from the computer science or math angle or AI is only one part. You need to supplement with the domain knowledge as well. So the next point what we are trying to discuss, all of you, I'm sure most of you may be of the software engineers and you may be talking about the software development lifecycle. That's what on the right side, where the problem is very deterministic in nature. We are talking about how to take the problem, deterministic problem, and then plan for it and design it, deploy it. Okay, and maybe in the part of the game of testing and then continuous integration and development. But when it comes to the DSLC, as you see, most of the cases what we experienced in the real world are of two types. One is from the real world business problems. I have a business problem. I don't know what data really solves it. Let me see what data I need to collect is one way of looking at. Second point is I have a lot of data and people in the world talking about a lot of data science and all. Let me see with the data what problems I need to solve. From both the sides, I'm not saying one is better than the other, but from both the sides, we need to talk about real business use case and what data we need to do. When it comes to that, it is right from the data acquisition and you need to prepare the data. And if you see, the main point is there is a lot of iterative process. You may need to do a small POC at a small scale and right from your random sampling or maybe stratified sampling. There are important concepts. It's not like a deterministic point. You are starting with a hypothesis. You are building the model to prove it, okay? Even if you prove it, if it is working with so-and-so accuracy or specificity, sensitivity, but by the time you really deploy it, how you are making sure that this is the real representation of the, maybe the model for the data, okay? So those aspects we are talking about with these challenges. Because of these differences, we are seeing the regular DevOps, what we are talking about, may not be the same which can be used for the AI. So that's what the debate we are going to have. So with that background, the first takeaway for us is what are the real basics of this AI DevOps and the challenges and where do we can start. So if you see this kind of a diagram, if you just Google it, you will say DevOps. Most of you are familiar with, even for the people who are not really into that. The regular DevOps starts with, okay, the coding in simple words, even though there are 6-7 steps, I can say there is a piece of code which we are developing and how we are making it into the productionization, taking care of all this unit testing and then real development. And very importantly, the feedback. So that's also there in the software world. But what is coming to the, that's what you refer it into CI/CD. It's more like continuous integration we are talking about and continuous delivery or deployment. So the CI/CD. So the same CI/CD way for the AI lifecycle, what we have seen for the DSLC is actually talking about AI DevOps. Where you can use it? Is it more like, is it domain specific? Not really. We are talking about, we can use across the domain as long as you are, okay, the POC is done, the research phase is done. When I'm going really towards the real deployment, that's what we are talking about. But in that process, what are the real challenges when it compares to the regular DevOps? So easy to say, okay, this is a CI/CD way of AI lifecycle. AI is also a model like any other software. What is so different about that? So if you see the color coding there, the challenges I'm trying to cluster it in three ways. One is the data science way of looking at the challenges, data engineering way of looking at challenges, and there are other operational or general. The first point I'm talking about there is the main challenge. Okay, I can say that I have the trained data and I developed a model. This is the accuracy I'm getting, let's say 95% accuracy. But can you reproduce the same thing? In the regular software world also, that's a challenge, right? Maybe the testing guys may say that, okay, the department say that I'm not able to reproduce the bug. Or maybe he may raise a bug, but I'm not able to reproduce in my environment. These are common challenges. But more importantly for us, the data, what we are talking about, is it a true representation of the real world? Otherwise, how do you make sure that the model, what we build, is correct for the real world? That's the first one. Second thing is, I'm sure whatever the data you take it, there will be always the real world noise or challenges. So how do you take that model degradation? Okay, there is a performance degrade. Okay, it's not getting 95%. But how do you identify these are the specific cases? These are not like one-off cases. The data is a true representation. The pattern changed. How do you retrain it? Are you doing it in a federated way? Or are you talking about doing it in a centralized way? How do you identify the model drift? Okay, there is a real drift, I need to train it. Do I need to train from the scratch or do I need to train only for the incremental point? There are a lot of points on that one. I'll leave it with you some thoughts, but this is also one of the important challenge for us. Then another point is, how do you validate the model? So we are talking about edge AI, explainable AI, even on that front as well. One is, some models are already black box, but at the same time, we are talking about supplementing that with some kind of surrogate models to explain it. But even in that angle, how do you make sure that this is the validation correct? One is validating the results of it, and at the same time, what explanations it is giving, is it really correct? So that make it much more complex. These are from the data science angle. When it comes to the data engineering aspect, the regular point, how do you deploy it? Where you are really deploying? Are you talking about a cloud deployment? Are you talking about the edge level deployment? Those are the challenges. I'll talk about some more in detail. Some of them are maybe simple for us, is something like, how do you storage it, version? You may argue that, okay, that's similar to our software. I will also say that way. So you can use your Jenkins kind of a integration points, similar thing we can talk about. But that is also an important point, which is not the case a couple of years ago. Why we are talking about it is, when we are talking about 2019 or 2020 is, these days only across the, I can use the term democratizing AI. So it is going towards not just only POC level, real deployment. That's what we are talking about as an important aspect here. Then scaling, it may work for the small level, but how do you make sure, whether it is a offline processing or maybe a real-time analytics using the Spark, but how do you scale it? Are we ready for it? Another important point on the same front is the ETL. How many people really understand what ETL means? Extract, transform, and loading, right? So most of the cases, I don't want to attempt to use those acronyms, but as long as it's standard, I hope I can use that. Separation of ETL from the ML model. That means model development, you don't really require to think of ETL in the beginning, right? But when you're really trying to deploy it, how do you extract it? Whether you use Kafka to as a message broker, or how you are deploying it as a Docker, there are multiple aspects. But while designing those aspects, the separation of ETL from ML is also a challenge for us. Then if you see the other ones, you may be tempted to use a lot of open source code, and these days what we say is, don't try to reinvent the wheel. If there is something already there in the open source, as long as your company talking about the perspective license, because there are so many licenses, right? GPL, LGPL, Apache. So as long as you can use directly, better use it, but be careful on that. Sometimes we may be using it, but we can't ship it. So those kind of things also, the challenges when it comes to the real deployment. For POC level, nobody bothers. As long as you are in the right direction, you can use it. Then how do you automate the process? In case of regular DevOps, because a lot of development happened, so many things, whether it's automation testing and a lot of, once you are ready with, okay, these many tests are there, these many changes are there, you can do it, the automation process. Are we ready yet? That is the question we are trying to answer. At a nutshell, we are not completely answered all the challenges. The main point for us as a takeaway is, there are some aspects which we can start with, but we don't have answers for all of them. Going forward, you and me can work on those. When we talk about these challenges and what is AI DevOps, are we really starting from scratch? Not really. So that's what we are talking about, some of the frameworks for you, where this is not any means exhaustive list. This is like some of the snapshots in terms of from Databricks. That's what maybe Spark everybody know, right? So Databricks also anybody worked on? Some of you, good. So this is also coming from Spark team. Okay, so that is called MLFlow. Then if you are familiar with Azure or Amazon or Google, everybody, because they are cloud service providers, they are also providing us not just only to develop the model, the environment, but even to deploy it and maintain it. So we'll see some of the aspects on that. So the color coding, what it indicates is only we are covering in the interest of time, only 2-3 of them, and you can explore the remaining ones. All of them are not free. I'll talk about that. So MLflow has, the Databricks provides two options for us. One is the open source one, another one is a managed MLflow. So the features-wise, it is common. I mean, the basic features are common, but as a customer, an enterprise customer, you can expect a little more. That I'll talk at the later point. But the basic things, what it's trying to help us is what you expect from the end-to-end ML development, deployment, and maintenance, it is going to provide us a platform that's coming from the Databricks. In a nutshell, they are talking about three features, or three components, let me put this way. One is on how do you do this tracking of the experiments. That's what the first piece. Then that means you need to log each and every aspect, and then how do you integrate your notebooks, what you developed. Then how do you talk about these projects, okay, in terms of maybe ML kind of a method for project tracking. Then models, once you have the model, how do you see the CI/CD way? Wherever I am using CI/CD is for continuous integration and continuous delivery. So these are the basic features. Yes, that is open source one you can talk about, but if you want to extend it further as an enterprise solution, they do have kind of a built-in streaming analytics, then make more security features. But what you refer here is managed versus open source, because the MLflow, as I mentioned, it has both enterprise version and even a free version. So we can start with free. That means the open source one. See how it really working for your needs. I know some people who are really inspired from these, but they developed their own framework. Okay, but whatever the things which are there in the good documentation for this one, something is because of the open source, you can definitely build on top of that. Nobody stops you on that. But the recommendation here is you can first try that. Then the positive point is that a lot of documentation is available and easily integratable with Spark, because most of them, even though there are a lot of things like Storm and all, but most of us are using the Spark, so there's also an advantage here. And it's not specific to one industry. You can apply across the industries, okay? As long as there is a real world models which you want to deploy. So the incremental points, I will not repeat what is the common thing for Amazon or maybe the Azure point of view. Definitely they are much more scalable, they are available because of the paid service. But the main point here is it's a broad framework, it's supporting a lot of frameworks. So if I ask you how many frameworks you are all familiar with, maybe more than 2-3 frameworks, anybody familiar? Like PyTorch, TensorFlow, MXNet in the room? Not many people, yes. Okay, but very few people. But are we expecting that you need to be master in different frameworks? Not really. Okay, I'll leave it with some thoughts, something like ONNX at the end. There are some standardization activities happening. Even if you are comfortable with TensorFlow, PyTorch, good enough, even one framework. Later on, there are methods, as we speak, converting from one model to the other one, so which are not there a couple of years ago. I'll leave it that points. So, but the advantage here is this is a framework supporting. You may be developing based on your convenience, multiple, you may develop the frameworks, you may use to build the models multiple frameworks, it doesn't matter, so it can support from execution point of view. And there is something like a CloudWatch to see all these monitoring aspects. Then how do you easily deploy it and how to auto-scale it? That should be the main advantage, right? When you come to the cloud, auto-scaling should be by default. Similarly, from Microsoft point of view, it is also managed cloud service. The main point is it has a flexible ML pipeline. At the same time, it is trying to give some kind of a advanced hyperparameter tuning. So as a data scientist, what you are trying to do? There are tens of parameters which I need to execute it, and within the time bound, how intelligently I can choose it. So I call it as something like a more of art than science. If it's completely scientific, then do we really require a data scientist, or I can put something like AutoML? If it's really scientific and choosing those parameters for the hyperparameters or parameter different values, if it's as long as it's scientific, we can make it an automatic system. But because it requires a lot of domain knowledge and the context, a lot of us are really working towards that within the stipulated time. So they do have even the DevOps support, and even more importantly, FPGA accelerators as well available. The reason is, the end goal is not just only a development of a model. I'll use something like total cost of ownership. Once we develop the model, how fast I'm able to execute? Am I really taking the benefits of hardware and software optimizations? Those are the things we are talking. So that gives to the next point. We talked about there are some frameworks. We talked about challenges in the AI DevOps journey. You can use any of the open source, or maybe if you're already hooked to this Azure or any of this AWS, you have already frameworks to start with. But that is only for the cloud environment. But when it comes to the edge, what are the use cases? You can think that, what could be the edge devices which you can think of? Is our mobile is also an edge? Or what are the other things can come to your mind? Maybe some kind of a drone, or maybe CCTVs, okay? And it can be as a small foothold of cameras. Those are also, we are talking about edge. Can we run the deep learning as we speak 2020? Can we run those our deep learning inference on those devices? Yes, we can. I'm not saying training point of view, at least from the deployment point of view, there is something like TensorFlow Lite, PyTorch also recently came as PyTorch Mobile. Okay, you can deploy it actually. And there, if I remember Qualcomm and Samsung, those kind of chips also, they are talking about performance improvements. Most of us are using those chips only in our mobiles, right? So there's a lot of advances happening. Let me take one to use cases to make my point strong. This is more like visual intelligence kind of examples for telco, but the same things you can apply your own, wherever there is some kind of images. And for instance, what I'm showing it to you there is some, are we ready for weatherproofing? So as our organization into this, providing this 4G, 5G technology, you see a lot of these towers, cell towers, and then how do you maintain that? If you ever think of it, are they really exposed? If some part is exposed like this, what does that mean? The performance degrades, so the call quality will go down. This is like a physical aspect because they're exposed to the real world. So maybe a couple of years ago, it may be completely manual. Okay, some tower is, a lot of complaints are coming, let somebody climb all the way and then do the maintenance. It may be just covering this, closing those nuts and bolts with the whatever the insulation. It's maybe as simple as that. But we are taking the advantage of the technology. Okay, let the drone take the images and provide us, and use object detection kind of whatever you are familiar with, object detection, single shot, two shot, all the algorithm point. These are the real use case I'm talking about, where it can be a cable bending aspect, or maybe kind of identifying what cable it is transfer, and then what are the weather proofing. There are multiple applications like that. The key point there is we are not trying to run the models, whatever we develop, in the cloud. Okay, we are using all these GPU servers and all that to develop it, but when it comes to the deployment, maybe I can give a scenario, okay, there is an issue identified because of these drone images, whatever we are getting, there is an object detection, we see this exposed part, we are sending a technician to climb there. We are not talking about at this stage, okay, a robo climbing and fixing it, that may be a futuristic, but now somebody is going it and fixing it. But he needs to climb tens of meters and fix it, but how he ensures that the, whatever he fix, he has done is correct? Why can't he carry some kind of a tab or mobile or anything in the edge and then verify then and there and get certified and then come back? Otherwise, he need to again go back. So that's where the edge real deployments we are talking about. But what brings to us in that phase is, I'll give you with the 2 points. Now I understand is there is a real cases. I think I excited you enough. There are real use cases where we need to run. It's not just only for the fun sake, but there are real use cases for running the models at the edge. When it comes to that, okay, what are the points I need to remember, I need to take care of, okay, right from the beginning? It's more like maybe a couple of years ago we are talking about those things are not, doesn't matter, okay. I'm really proving a use case. This much is what my, maybe in case of object detection, this much is my IOU, this much is my MAP, these are the terms if you are familiar with, or maybe some performance metrics like accuracy. That's good enough. But now, when we talk about that, the target deployment is going to be different because it's not going to be as smooth as a GPU servers like a training environment. In that particular case, what I'm arguing there is there are something like Intel Inference Engine, then NVIDIA has TensorRT. These are different from our regular frameworks. You may be developing it with TensorFlow, fine, or maybe any of the deep learning framework which you are comfortable with. Once you have the base model, if I convert that into an intermediate representation, something like .xml, .bin, generic formats, so what is the output of a deep learning model? What it contains in the output? It's kind of architecture and weights. All of you agree with me? So it's more like XML is containing that particular architecture and bin maybe the weights. But the main point is, why we are talking about these kind of hardware vendors also in this particular case is the execution of it is tuned, okay, in the performance of order. The example I was talking about, I haven't changed anything the model in the training. I have the model. I just run that to a different format so that the execution will be faster in the hardware, whether it is a CPU of Intel or maybe a Tensor RT from NVIDIA, okay, the GPU point of view. The point I am referring here is, you think of there are some kind of a post-processing operations where you can convert the same model, whatever the hard work you have done, maybe some kind of a quantize. I'm not going into details, okay? It may be some quantization, some kind of pre-compiling, let it do the math operations. But we are, can get the benefit of faster execution. Just to give you a sample, frames per second is one of the metric. I may be running with the base model, maybe two images, or maybe two, or in this particular case, 5 images per second is my throughput. By not changing any of the model, just by using these kind of execution, we are able to increase that to 25. Even I have cases in previous use case from healthcare, we went up to even 100 images per second instead of 5. So the potential, those also you need to leverage. That's what the key takeaway from the second point. Okay, it is easy to say that there is a cloud implementation, there is an edge implementation, there are some of these frameworks, but as a developer or as a data scientist, so what are the different trade-offs I need to play with? What comes to your mind when it comes to the trade-off, the first trade-off what we are familiar with in machine learning? Bias variance, very good, okay. But is that the only trade-off we need to make? Okay, so that's what I mentioned. We need to think beyond bias variance, okay. So that's what anyway we are studied, and then there are a lot of things which we know the importance of that. I'm not talking on that because it's a very basic one. But when it comes to the next level, some of the points you may be familiar with, but some of them I can explain while I'm taking the example. These were the last takeaway for us is, how do you see the throughput versus latency? Because some of the cases we can't, the trade-off means what? If I want to increase the latency, maybe I need to compromise on the throughput, okay? So similarly, security, explainability, and accuracy. So we know the standard ones, if I need to make more secure, maybe it should not be as much as explainable. It should be a black box. But I may not be able to satisfy the regulatory requirements or maybe the end customer requirements, I may need to explain it. At the same time, if the complex model is there, maybe my explainability will reduce, but the accuracy may increase. So these kind of trade-offs we need to make. Then training time versus network complexity. I hope most of you will agree that. As you have more time, maybe the complexity you can increase it. The last one may be a lot of points I'm combining there. The rate of learning, that means how frequently I need to retrain it versus programmability. What is it? Mostly the Python may be a default language for most of us, but you do have different frameworks to choose, whether I need to choose PyTorch, whether I need to choose TensorFlow or something else. And then size of the model, that's more close to the network complexity only. How the trend is, it's not like, okay, I have developed a model with 1,000 layers. It's not like a thing to boast of. The same problem, if I solve it with 100 layers, that may be the thing which we need to boast of as we speak. Then the energy. Finally, the thing, energy efficiency, because it needs to run on some kind of a edge or maybe the cloud. What is the total cost of ownership? How many dollars we are burning to make that inference? So those are the things which are coming to us. So to remember all that, it became complex. That's why I'm taking the help of this acronyms. So the PLASTER, as I mentioned, most of the things are covered. The PLASTER means programmability, latency, accuracy, S for size of the model, then T for throughput, E for energy efficiency, and R for rate of learning. This is what, not my acronym, so this is given by NVIDIA. So I need to attribute the credits to them. That's why I given the reference. But on top of that, the SCT, what I coined for that, for you to easily remember, is S for security, E for explainability, T for training time. So maybe the idea for PLASTER is mostly to, during the inference phase, how do you maybe extract the best performance? How do you do the trade-off? But when I'm referring to the PLASTER Plus set as a guideline for us, it's not just only at the inference time, because the choice for us to choose what framework maybe starts from the business statement like this. So for instance, I may need to develop a model. It's not like the model, okay, I will give you a business problem, I give you the data, just develop, and maybe evaluation criteria is, okay, it should reach to 95% of the accuracy, maybe 92% of sensitivity. These are all okay. But the business problems nowadays, what are coming is, I need to deploy it in the end device, which should not cost, let's say, more than 10,000 rupees, whether it's an end terminal or maybe kind of a camera. So while choosing that, I need to intelligently choose right from the framework or maybe right from the model. Suppose if the image classification, you may know so many models like Retina Net, Mobile Net, Inception Net, but which one to start with? Maybe something like Edge means you may start with Mobile Net because it's a lower footprint compared to the other ones. So these kind of design choices I'm talking about here, I'll give some examples and then open for questions. So the first one, okay, whatever I referred, I will go a little more details in terms of, because these are the things which I feel one of the key takeaway in terms of, it's not like you need to give importance to, let's say the first one, throughput, not the latency. We need to decide based on the real situation. Let me define some of the terms which are, latency means what? Let's say if you just Google search and then get the response, how much time you will wait for a response? If the, let's say, connectivity is good, few milliseconds it will take, that's it. So it's more like when I query for it, how much time I need to wait for it. The same way, when I query a model, how much time I need to take for me to get the response. Whereas throughput, what it is taking is how many such requests you can take per second. So do you see the trade-off there? If I want to service, maybe if my model is designed to service only, let's say, 2 requests per second, if I bombard with 5, what will happen? The throughput will impact. Okay, throughput may be 5, but latency will impact. So we need to have a trade-off. That means what is the balance we are talking about is, let first define the latency limit. Within that, try to maximize the throughput, how much ever it is. So that's what one of the trade-off we are talking about. Second thing is, as we given a hints for that in terms of security, explainability, accuracy, if you want more accuracy, I need complex model. Okay, how complex if I go, then I may not directly able to explain it. Okay, you can talk, I have LIME, SHAP, and these kind of tools, I can explain it, some surrogate models. There's also a lot of development is happening on that. That's also good, but how much you need to explain? Okay, if you make it more explainable, then it may be a threat for you. Somebody will, maybe the hard work of yours, all your 1 year of hard work and building the model, somebody will hijack that or provide some adversarial attacks. So we need to have, okay, one is having aware of those kind of models and attacks and give the relevant information to the relevant user. That's what we talk about there. And another important aspect here is the DL model, you can train it on high performance, I mean, high precision, something like a floating point 32, floating point 64 like, but you can implement at a lower precision, something like int 8, because the same floating point 32 kind of things may not be able to work in your edge device, right? So that flexibility is very good for us. Even there may be a little drop in the accuracy, but not to the extent which we need to worry about. So the next one in the journey is, how do you see the training? This may be a little simple compared to the other ones, where training time versus network complexity. So where if you want to increase the network complexity, naturally the time will be more. But always for us, the common constraint for us is the time. We need to deliver within the time. So how do you see the best practices across the domain? Okay, whether it is a transfer learning kind of an aspect, or maybe the best practices, even whether you are training a GAN, whether you are trying a simple classification, there are some lot of open source information for us. So how do you see so that we don't want to reinvent the wheel? That's what I talked about, even choose the level of complexity. If I know the end device is a kind of an edge to run, maybe take a simple model, something like a mobile net compared to the best. Maybe that may not be the best on the in the literature, but still we can go with that. So the last point on that front is, maybe there are a lot of things I combined there, but there is a reason I can link through that so that you can appreciate that point. The rate of learning is how is more like very close to the DevOps, how often you need to retrain. Okay, your model, how do you identify the drift? Okay, when it comes to that, I can say that, okay, every day you do it, or maybe every couple of hours you do it, but it has a catch, right? That programmability, how is it really doing automatic modeling, or maybe the engineers needs to involve? That means how comfortable our engineers are in that programmability aspect, so they are linked that way. Then size of the model, if you increase the size of the model, naturally it needs to add a lot of giga operations at the end of the thing. That's where it linked to the energy efficiency. If the model is light, then your total cost of ownership, that's what I can link it to, all this energy efficiency, size of the model, all that are related to total cost of ownership. So as we speak, the main point here is the developing a best model. For instance, I keep giving this example. One team developed a best model with 97% of accuracy, but the footprint of they might use, let's say, 500 layers. Whereas other people have only, let's say, 95% instead of 97%, but still they have played with only 100 layers and the footprint is less. Maybe I may go with that in the final production. Okay, so think broad and in the aspects of multiple points which we discussed now. Then the last point, okay, what are the recent developments in this space? So from the open source point, there are so many things happening, but especially I want to just bring to you these two points as a reference. From the Linux Foundation Open Source AI, there are a lot of things even from there, but I'm referring here two points. One is on ECMAS, other one is on the ONNX. So what is there in the ECMAS? Maybe you can think it as a open source AI marketplace. You can also subscribe to that, and you can use how you can implement for your own organizations, maybe a startup or maybe a big giant in your domain. What it is trying to offer there, the picture-wise, is how do you develop it, deploy it, and make sure the models are available for us. For us means the end customers for us. So, and you can modify it. The beautiful point is maybe Jenkins is not part of it, or maybe some of the common tools are not part of it for you for the CI/CD point, but you can add to that, okay? So it's also a continuous journey on that front. Then I was giving a hint for you on the ONNX. How many people heard of that? Some of you, good. So I have good appreciation for this is mainly for because I might have run some 4 or 5 different frameworks, maybe Cafe, Theano, so many people not even have good respect maybe for those because these are so fast they are outdating, right? So we are talking about only TensorFlow and PyTorch now. But there are so many frameworks, and that too, the real situation is not to worry about those many frameworks. The point there is, maybe CNTK is coming from where? Which company? Microsoft, then MXNet from Amazon, because they are the cloud providers, they may say that if you use our framework, maybe the total cost of ownership may be less. Is it a fair point or not? Does it mean that I need to rewrite again instead of TensorFlow using that? So to do that aspect, especially the interoperability point of view, to move the models from one framework to the other framework, I have good respect for this kind of ONNX kind of a standards. Okay, it's still evolving, but a lot of efforts are already in place, mainly for two reasons. On the interoperability I was talking about. Second thing on hardware access. If you have hardware, whether it's edge device or Intel or NVIDIA at the end, how do you really take the best out of that? Okay, those are the two points I was referring there. So I'm well within the time. So if I summarize the 3 points or the key takeaways for us, I talked about what are the basics of AI DevOps, and then what is AI DevOps and why we are using it. What are the real challenges, both from data science angle and data engineering angle? Then we talked about, do we need to really start from scratch? Not really. Some framework, something like MLFlow or Amazon and SageMaker or Azure has providing the ML service. You can use those. Or I'm leaving with your thoughts saying that you can even develop your own framework. Nobody stops using that. But start from that open source, something like MLFlow, that will help you out. Then the end goal is not just only to have the, let's say, the accuracy of the so-and-so percentage, but the end goal is where you're really deploying, whether it is in a cloud or on the edge. So in the edge point, we are referring to something like Intel OpenVINO or Inference Engine. I might not have used the term OpenVINO. But if you just Google it, you will get these different frameworks. Is now, as we speak in 2020, it is very easy for us. It's more like during our beta versions, we need to spend a lot of hours to download it and convert it and all, but now it's more like a commoditized, let me put that way. So it is on us to really use those which are available. Then I know some people are in the research background, so what are the real research, something on the implementation point of view, these are the tools I was referring to, but let me leave you with some thoughts from research angle as well. You can think something on the model drift, that means maybe in your own domain, maybe something from the mathematical angle, maybe from your domain angle, how do you really identify the drift in the model? That means I developed something on the based on the training data set, but the training data set, but in the test data, there is mismatch of the distribution. How do you really identify that? And what kind of techniques I can use for online learning in that? Does it need to be kind of federated learning based on your situation, or maybe a regular learning? That's up. We can take based on the case to case. But these are the ones which I want to leave it with. The last point is, don't think just building a model. Think from end-to-end development of the model, which can optimize the total cost of ownership. So with that, these are the couple of references which I used it for. I'm open for questions.